This is Bing Crosby in the Kraft Music Hall with Jimmy Dorsey and the Cats. Paul Taylor singers, Bob Burns, Rudolph Gans, one of the country's leading pianists, who, I'm warning you, has worked out a little something for himself and Bob to do. Miss Zazu Pitts, who I hope you didn't come in too late to meet, but if you did, that'll just learn you to get here in time. And at the moment, Miss Gail Patrick, those of our clients who were fortunate enough to see New Universal's solid box office smash, My Man Godfrey, are already acquainted with my friend Gail Patrick. Gail being the gal who garnered considerable critical acclaim as Carol Lombard's sister and the rival for the affections of William Godfrey Powell. Of course, if your movie memory dates back a couple of years, you may recall that Gail Patrick and I had the honor of working together in support of W.C. Fields in a frothy little musical whimsy the Paramount people called Mississippi.
Mm-hmm. The year Alabama played Stanford, wasn't
it? Quiet, I don't want to hear any more about that. Cost me my shirt. Since then, and always by courtesy of Paramount, Gail Patrick has worked at almost every major studio in Hollywood. She's at present involved on the home lot in the manufacture of a little celluloid bobble, soon to be released to a waiting world under the intriguing title of Artists and Models. In my veiled way, what I'm inferring is that the movie moguls certainly keep Gail pretty busy.
Well, I've been awful lucky, too, Bing, and I've had a lot of fun.
It's nice to hear you've had a lot of fun, but I can't put in with you on that lucky business. People don't get parts in smash hit pictures like My Man Godfrey just by sheer luck.
Maybe most people don't, but I did, being, as I said, awful lucky.
Well, give us the formula for that kind of luck, will you?
Yeah, I could use a little of that.
Well, to begin with, I was scheduled to do a little Western over at Paramount.
You mean one of them rip-roaring horse operas like Two Gun Crosby plays in?
Yeah, but Two Gun wasn't slated to be in the one they had me in mind for.
Lady, you are lucky.
Nick's cracking. Nick's cracking, Robin. What changed your plans, Gail?
I really don't know, Bing, but all of a sudden I found myself being sent out to Universal to do Godfrey with Gregory LaCava.
Well, I've played plenty of golf with Greg, but I've never felt the sting of his directorial lash. Misha tells me his methods of making pictures are somewhat eerie.
Well, I should say bizarre, to
bizarre,
put it mildly.
That's a better word.
In the first place, Greg LaCava never shoots a picture with a script.
That's so when he's half through with a picture, you don't have to shoot the script right.
Well, it's really a lot of fun, Bob, watching the dialogue work itself out as you go along.
That's where the fun comes in. Well, that sounds definitely like the hard way to me, making a six with two trays.
Oh, but it really isn't. Everyone has a synopsis of the story, and the dialogue's tailored to fit the way you and the character would talk naturally.
Lady, there ain't a tailor living could fit the way Bing talks.
That's what you think. But if Bing were working with LaCava, the tailoring job would amaze you.
Well, Bob could really pad his part then. He'd wind up with an eight-reel solo, unmolested.
Yeah, it'd be great for me, Bing, but nobody'd ever find out what you're trying to say.
Well, is that bad? People don't know what Einstein's talking about either, but he's a highly respected citizen.
Yeah, but he don't confuse the folks by crooning.
Pardon me, boys. Is this a private fight, or can anybody get into
Come
it?
Come in fighting, Gail, but carry your left high, because Burns is deadly tonight.
Say, don't it take an awful long time for LaCava to find a picture that everybody's sitting around trying to think up funny lines for himself?
Well, the people LaCava uses probably don't take as long to think up funny lines as you do, Robert.
Why, Bing Crosby, you know I'm quick.
Oh, you're not.
I am, too.
Yay.
I am.
That's just the sort of thing there ain't none of on a LaCava. Everybody seems to know what Greg wants, and they all do their best to give it to him.
Just one big happy family.
It really is.
Well, what time in the morning does LaCava bring his company around to your house to shoot the picture?
Oh, he lets you go to the studio to work.
Oh, the slave driver.
Well, I guess he sort of thought some of us might like to see the inside of a studio. But there's one thing about it. If LaCava has you called for 9:20, you start to work at 9:20. There's none of that sitting around waiting for a couple of days.
Well, with none of that sitting around and waiting, how did any of the actors in Godfrey get time to read Gone with the Wind?
He looked out for all that, too. Greg starts shooting promptly at 9 in the morning, but he stops promptly at 6 in the evening.
Well, that seems like a curious combination of orderliness and chaos. Shooting without a script and still keeping regular hours.
And keeping everybody happy and having a good time. It sounds disgusting, doesn't it?
No.
But honestly, as I said before, I've never worked on a picture where there was less display of temperament and petty jealousies than there were in Godfrey.
Well, maybe LaCava's got the right recipe for making hit pictures.
Oh, I'm sure of that. He says you should never seem to be working for a hit picture. It makes everyone try too hard.
Easy gets it.
Huh? That's the motto.
Well, look, just so when Burns and I start producing and directing pictures, we know all LaCava's tricks. Supposing you pretend you're Greg LaCava directing a scene for My Man Godfrey.
I'd be glad to, but he'll probably get his revenge. I just was handed the glad tidings that Paramount's loaned me to RKO for a part in Stage Door that Greg's directing. However, to get to Godfrey, I'll need a Bill Powell and a Carol Lombard.
Carol, well, dag nabbit, neither of them could make it this evening, but I'd be glad to play Carol.
Say, who wouldn't?
I'd be glad to take the part of Carol Lombard, and short of Bill Powell himself, you ain't never going to find a smoother Powell than Mr. Burns.
Okay, Bing, I think you have something there anyway. Now, I'm Gregory LaCava.
Yeah, Bing's Carol Lombard.
And Bob's Bill Powell. Now, go ahead, LaCava.
Here we go. Are you ready, Carol and Bill?
We're ready, you Simon Legree.
Let's get going.
Well, here's the situation. Carol, you're a silly little girl who's really very, very much in love with your father's butler, Godfrey.
That's me.
Well, that's going to take some acting, but let's try.
Now, wait just a minute. The conflict in the scene is this. There always has to be a conflict.
Mm-hmm.
Godfrey's really in love with you, Carol, but he won't give in.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to make love to him. You want to try?
I throw myself at him.
And I duck.
That's right. Let's go. This is a take.
Honest, Godfrey, I'm crazy about you. I don't know what to do. I want to follow you around like a dog. Kiss me, Godfrey. Kiss me.
Now, you see. You see how silly you are. Don't you know there are germs in kisses?
Oh, willy-nilly, I don't care. It doesn't make any difference to me. When I kiss hard enough to kill the germ.
Well. I want to tell you right now, you ain't going to smash any of my bugs.
Getting particular.
Honest, Godfrey, you ought to kiss me. Everybody says I'm a hot potato.
Well, I...
Only kill McKinley.
Yeah, well, I ain't no potato masher.
Cut!
How was it?
Well, that's just the sort of smooth, sophisticated dialogue we needed for that Western they took me out of.
Well, thanks. What's next?
I'll leave that up to you. Sing, Crosby.
Close your sleepy eyes, my little buckaroo.
While the light of Western sky is shining down on you, don't you know it's time for bed? Another day is through. So go to sleep, my little buckaroo. Don't you realize, my little buckaroo, it was from a little acorn that the oak tree grew. And remember, Buffalo Bill was once a kid like you. So go to sleep, my little buckaroo. Soon you're gonna ride the range like grown-up cowboys do. Now it's time that you were rounding up a dream or two. So go to sleep, my little buckaroo.
Looks like Gail swung me into that little buckaroo so fast I didn't get time to thank her for the interesting little expose on the working methods of one of Hollywood's outstanding directors. Thank you, Gail. And will you drop around in the hall again sometime?
I'm going to hold you to that invitation, Bing.
You got a rain check.
Say, what are all the whispering conferences that have been going on around here between Rudolph Garns and Bob Burns?
Well, since you broached the subject, Gail, you're going to get the full lowdown directly. As all our regular clients of the hall surely know, Rudolph Garns, known to his intimate friends and paid-up alumni of the Kraft Music Hall as Rudy, has been playing piano in America for over 30 years. He is, in fact, the head man at the Chicago Musical College and has garnered himself considerable critical praise and prestige for having piloted the St. Louis Symphony Orchestra for a little matter of some 6 years, as well as guest conducted practically every top flight symphony combo from the Hollywood Bowl to the stadium in New York City. As his first selection here this evening, Rudolph Garns plays Franz Liszt's Forgotten Waltz. You remember it, Rudy? I think that surely constitutes as nice a piece of Forgotten Waltz remembering as we've seen around here in many a moon.
Thank you, Bing. Now, if it's all right, the same to you, Bob Burns and I have a little musical matter to go over together.
Hmm. Yeah, Bing, at last I've found a musician who really appreciates the bazooka.
That's funny. Funny thing. To look at Rudy, you'd swear he was all right. No outward indications of aberration. I got to demand my little pound of flesh from Ruby before he and Burns get off their little chalk talk.
Bing, you're only standing in the way of progress.
Well, I might be, but I'll give you 8-5. You and Rudy ain't going to do music any good when you get started. Fact is, friends, Rudy promised to get off a little of my favorite composer for me. That would, of course, be a melody by Claude Debussy. It's called Puerto del Vino.
What does that mean?
Port of the wine, or door to the wine, or tavern, or inn, or
gin mill.
nice title for a number by Claude Debussy.
Now, may I tell you how to pronounce Debussy's name?
What, you mean I got it wrong?
I'll show you on the piano.
He's going to sing it to you, Bing. Even Gantz turns out to be a crooner. You can't tell what's going to happen around here.
Now, listen, Bing. Here is how to pronounce the name of Claude Debussy. I heard the combat about his name a few weeks ago. And with all due respect to all those involved in that little free-for-all, I feel I must rush to the poor man's defense.
Well, naturally, I suppose as a member of the French Legion of Honor, you could do no less. How'd he like to have his name pronounced?
Like this. It is not Debussy, Debussy.
Debussy. But, how then?
Debussy. Debussy.
Debussy. Debussy, how's that?
I think I got it, Rudy.
Debussy. Oh, Debussy. Rudolph Gans playing Claude Debussy's Puerta del Vin. Thanks again, Rudy. And now, if you wish, I'll just step aside and you and Burns can have your little moment.
Yeah, and after you hear this, Bing, you won't care how to pronounce it. Debussy.
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 Yeah.
Rudy has written a lullaby for Bazooka.
Good night, all.
After all, Bing, why not? As I say to the students of the University of Kansas at Lawrence, I'm not a youngster in years, but I'm young musically.
Mm-hmm.
If Paul Whiteman can conduct the Philadelphia Symphony and Leopold Stokowski go into the movies, if George Gershwin can write a concerto for piano and orchestra and Ravel write a blues, if Yasha Heifetz can get his picture taken playing the accordion why can't I write a lullaby for Bazooka?
Well, you got yourself into it. You wriggle out of it the best way you can. Just leave me out of this.
Yeah, he ain't got no soul for art, Rudy. Come on, let's bang out this number.
Here's Rudolph Garns, friends, and Robin Burns playing Rudolph Garns' latest composition, Lullaby for Bazooka. Oh, help. Really very touching indeed.
Thank you, Bing. But I'm afraid it was a little too successful. The bazooka has gone to sleep. The bazooka snoozes.
And you should have called it a snoozer for bazooka. Anyhow, we got rid of him. And thanks, Rudy, for a stimulating visit to the hall. Dr. Dorsey and his semi-classical cats are about to accomplish something that even Jack Benny couldn't handle. Jack messed around a little with Franz Schubert's The Bee, but Dr. Dorsey and his colleagues got a bee here that Jack probably couldn't even pronounce. Rimsky-Korsakov's idea of the love book, which old R.K. called The Flight of the Bumblebee. Dr. Dorsey himself carries the refrain on the E-flat alto. The tempo is, of course, molto accelerando. The result will, I'm sure, amaze and electrify you. Kick her over, Jim.
Thank you.
Oh, that was swell, Jimmy. That probably might better be titled The Fright of the Bumblebee, which gives us just the opportunity we're looking for to edge in a fellow whose life work is to carry on the business of the hall while we play and just make merry. Carry on the business right now, my friend.
Attention June brides and all other homemakers. Men folks, as you know, are fussy about food. But that doesn't mean that they want their food fussed up. You can often tempt them with the simplest fare, salads, for instance, provided you know this new way to make your salads extra delicious. Just try a jar of Kraft's Miracle Whip salad dressing. You'll discover the world-famous flavor that makes even the plainest salad exciting. The blend of mayonnaise and old-fashioned boiled dressing that men go for. Miracle Whip's special recipe calls for far more of the costly ingredients that make the difference between fine and ordinary salad dressings. And these finer ingredients are skillfully mixed in the exclusive Kraft Miracle Whip beater. The result, a flavor that is completely new and different. Not too tart, not too bland, but just right. One taste of Miracle Whip, and you'll see why millions prefer it to any other dressing. Why it outsells the next 20 leading salad dressings combined. Just ask your grocer for America's favorite, Miracle Whip salad dressing.
Where are you? Where have you gone without me? I thought you cared about me.
Gives you all we had lying around the hall, but things accumulate pretty fast here in the Kraft Music Hall, so we figure by next Thursday around this same time, we'll have a lot more stuff to sort out and go over. Maybe some of them fit you. Besides yourself, we're expecting my friend Charlie Ruggles, who plays on the first team with Paramount, one of the world's leading illustrators, the justly famous McClellan Barclay, and Miss Natalie Bodania of the Metropolitan Opera Company. Looks like a nice little singing organization. These, of course, are over and above such regular hard help as Bob Burns, Jimmy and the Swingsters, and Paul Taylor Chorus. So we'll see if you can make it next Thursday. Don't forget, we're setting a place for you. Good night.
The Kraft Music Hall, announced by Ken Carpenter, comes to you from the NBC studios in Hollywood. This is the Red Network of the National Broadcasting Company.